Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We're having an issue with the ladies' room this evening. So if any lady needs to use the restroom, we're going to ask you to use the men's room. And you'll be one of the ushers standing guard to protect us. We apologize and thank you.
Presiding at the Mass today will be Father Richard, and he will be assisted by Deacons Kingery and Porter. Let us begin this celebration of the Eucharist by joining together in song with hymn number 386, Gather the People. Hymn number 386, Please Rise.
Enter the feast, all are invited, the greatest. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
We should glory in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whom is our salvation, life, and resurrection, through whom we are saved and delivered. Amen.
Amen.
My dear friends, we have gathered here tonight to celebrate the first of three very, very, very important days in the life of the Church. Today, on Thursday, is the addition of the Eucharist. I thank all of you for being here. We started Mass this year a little early. We started last year, it was 7 p.m., I think. Nobody said, well, it's an hour early. I said, well, I forgot because I had brain surgery, so I have excuse. Anyway, I thank you so much for taking the time to be here this evening to celebrate this Mass. Before we continue with the celebration, I would invite you to have a seat. We will be introduced to the oils we'll be using for the rest of this liturgical year.
Presentation of the oils. The oil of catechumens is used during the rite of infant baptism and to bless adult catechumens during the time of study and preparation for baptism. The oil of catechumens. The oil of the sick is used by priests during the sacrament of the anointing of the sick to bring comfort and at times physical healing. The oil of the sick.
Let us prepare ourselves to enter this mystery of our faith, acknowledging our sinfulness, our weaknesses. May God heal us, renew us, and forgive us.
I confess.
To God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous faults. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary of the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. The Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to life everlasting.
Amen. Thank you.
O God, who have called us to participate in this most sacred supper, in which your only begotten Son, when about to hand himself over to death, entrusted to the Church a sacrifice new for all eternity, the banquet of his love, grant, we pray, that we may draw from so great a mystery the fullness of charity and of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Christ, The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Before the feast of Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to pass from this world to the Father. He loved his own in the world, and he loved them to the end. The devil had already induced Judas, son of Simon the Iscariot, to hand him over. So, during supper, fully aware that the Father had put everything into his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God, he rose from supper and took off his outer garments. He took a towel and tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and dry them with the towel around his waist. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Master, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered and said to him, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will understand later." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "Unless I wash you, you will have no inheritance with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Master, then not only my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus said to him, "Whoever has bathed has no need except to have his feet washed, for he is clean all over. So you are clean, but not all." For he knew who would betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." So when he had washed their feet and put his garments back on and reclined the table again, he said to them, "Do you realize what I have done for you? You call me teacher and master, and rightly so, for indeed I am. If I, therefore, the master and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet. I have given you a model to follow, so that as I have done for you, you should also do." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good evening.
Good evening, my Father.
We begin today the Triduum, the three great celebrations of our Catholic faith. For the first time, we hear the Lord Jesus say, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." St. Paul recalls those words in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 24. There are many, many wonderful things and events that happen in the life of the church. There are many times you come to Mass and you are not overwhelmed by incense like this. Why? Because this is different. The Triduum is different. We began the Lenten season with Ash Wednesday. So we have the Lenten season. Within the Lenten season, you have the season of Holy Week. Within Holy Week, you have Triduum, which is a season of its own. Within Holy Week, within Lent. That is how important these 3 days are. These celebrations are at the heart, the very heart of our faith, and eventually culminating in our divine worship. So we begin today with the celebration of the Lord's gift of the Most Holy Eucharist given through the priesthood he instituted. Tomorrow, Good Friday, we will enter with Christ into the mystery of his crucifixion. And then on Holy Saturday, we enter into the glory of his resurrection. So see it as one continuous liturgical celebration that begins today and ends on Saturday. So today, the Triduum, with the Last Supper. This event in history, which took place as a Passover meal, shared with Jesus and his apostles, begins the gift that brings all of us salvation. on Holy Thursday, we hear the Lord say for the first time, like I mentioned, "This is my body that is for you." We hear him point to the gift of the Holy Eucharist as his gift to us, giving for our own holiness and our fulfillment. It's a gift we will never be able to fathom or comprehend or fully understand. It's the gift of his complete self-giving and sacrificial love. If only we could understand fully what the Eucharist is. If only we could understand this precious and sacred gift, what St. Thomas Aquinas would say, that humanity is so privileged that food for angels has now become food for us. If only we could understand that. The Eucharist, in a real way, transforms us into Christ himself. As we consume the Holy Eucharist, we are drawn into the divine life of the Most Holy Trinity. We are made one with God and are given the food of eternity. On that first Holy Thursday, Jesus also offered an example of the perfect humility and service that we are called to imitate as one with him. He did the unthinkable. As far as his apostles were concerned, that was the unthinkable. He got up from supper, from dinner, got a bucket, got water, and washed their feet. Now today, after 3,000 years of history and perhaps being so used to this liturgical sequence that we encounter every year, it might not seem a whole lot to us. But take your minds back, if you could imagine traveling back into time when this event happened. How stunned the apostles were. They understood what Jesus was doing because it was part of their culture. So they knew that you wash someone's feet as a symbol of welcome. But then who washes their feet? Usually it is the slave in the household. So if you visited somebody back in the day, as a gesture of welcome to you, they would ask their slave to not only give you water to wash your feet, but the slave would wash your feet. Now you can imagine, not to sound too gross here, but you can imagine how their feet would have looked at the time. They walked everywhere they went. They had sandals, probably no socks, and there were no vehicles. Those who could afford it had donkeys. If you were very, very rich, you had a horse. And of course, if you were royal, you had some kind of a chariot of some kind. Those were the F-150s of the day. And then the traders went all over the place on camels. Camels would carry a lot of luggage and go for days and days through barren and arid regions. Perhaps we could say those were the semis of the day. So people walked everywhere they went. Dusty paths and through shrubs and everything. So when they came to your house, you welcomed them by washing their feet. So what Jesus was doing, they understood. But it wasn't supposed to be done by somebody like Jesus. As far as they were concerned, perhaps in the history of their lives, this was the first time they saw someone honorable, someone respected, someone of the caliber of Jesus, stooping down so low to wash someone's feet. This was unheard of. That is why I said Jesus did the unthinkable. But there was a reason why Jesus did this. He washed the feet of his apostles so as to teach them and us. His body and blood are given so as to enable us to love as he loved. The Eucharist transforms us into true servants who are called to humility. We are called to humble service of others. This service, of course, will take upon itself various forms. Some will be called to serve in the church, even in many different capacities. For me, I am a priest. We have deacons with us. We have the choir people. We have the organists. We have nuns. We have monks. We are called to do all kinds of many different things. And then you, perhaps, also are called to serve in many, many, many different ways in the church. You are called to be of service to humanity, perhaps maybe in your own fields of expertise in the work. Whatever it is, you are called to service in one way or the other. But the question always still has to be asked, do you feel called to serve? Do you feel called to serve humanity? Do you feel called to serve in the church? Do you feel called to do something for the sake of someone else? Are you moved to respond? In the Catholic Church, through discernment, we say when somebody feels moved, we say perhaps they are discerning the Holy Spirit. Maybe the Holy Spirit is calling that person to come and be of service in the church, in the parish, or perhaps start a movement to bring comfort and healing and peace to people. Whatever that is, are you called? Do you feel that Holy Spirit moving in you? Do you humble yourself before others to care for their most basic needs? How do you understand the basic needs of somebody if you do not come to their level, if you are not there with them? Pope Francis talks to us priests. He says that we should be shepherds. And he said we shouldn't just be called shepherds, and because the name sounds cool, he actually said cool, and everybody laughed. He says shepherds need to smell like the sheep. Pope Francis is always saying that to the priest when he writes a letter to us. I mean, not to me specifically, to us. Shepherds ought to smell like the sheep. In other words, be where the people are. Be with the people, he would always say, and he always says. But then how do we understand the brokenness, the loss that our people feel if we don't give an listening ear? And the only way to give a listening ear is to create the environment of humility and peacefulness where we can hear and understand, where we can listen. We just had a conference not too long ago about the synod, about listening. Are we listening to each other? Are we hearing what someone is saying, even without speaking? Do you show them you love them by your actions? This is at the heart of Holy Thursday. Humble service is a beautiful expression of our own intimate union with the Son of God. Jesus, in his service, in his person, offers a view of greatness that is in complete contrast with secular understanding of success and admiration, characterized by admiration and accomplishments. But on Holy Thursday, Jesus shows that true greatness is found in this humble act of service. Imitating him requires that we surrender our pride. And this ability to surrender is made possible when we consume the Holy Eucharist with faith, when we spend time in meditation, in prayer, when we constantly seek asking God, teach me, lead me, show me how you want me to be of service to you. We sang a song yesterday at Mass in the morning, where do you want me to serve you? It's a question we constantly have to be asking all the time. And what that love and service is an act that will win the hearts and souls of others for the kingdom of God. As we celebrate Holy Thursday, we are challenged, therefore, to ponder our own humility and to commit ourselves to a radical and total gift of self to others. Today is a day of a new command, a new beginning. Jesus looks at his friends and then he says, "You see what I have done? I need you to do it for others as well." Symbolically, we need to wash each other's feet. It's a sign of humility, a sign of love, a sign of self-emptying. When you go home, I'm sure a spouse would say, "Honey, let me wash your feet." And he will wash their feet as a sign of humility, a sign of respect, a sign of devotion, a sign of love, a sign of kindness, a sign of tenderness. Do that and see how things change. See what it feels like to be served and see what it feels like to serve. And that's a very, very beautiful thing. You should try some of these things at home sometime. I think it's a good thing. So it's a new commandment. Do this for others. So this opportunity that has been presented to us in Christ Jesus is precious. Let us grab it. Let us not only grab it, let Christ also wash not just our feet. As Peter says, "Lord, you want to wash my feet?" He says, "There's no way you can." Jesus says, "If I don't, you have no business with me." Peter says, now in the gospel, it sounds kind of sarcastic when Peter says, "Well, while you're at it, why not just wash my hands and my face and my hair and everything?" It sounds kind of sarcastic, but it's not. Tonight, my brothers and sisters, we are asking Jesus to not only wash our feet, but to wash off from us the things that we carry. What do we carry with us that requires this washing away? I have a list here. What if we invite Christ Jesus, not only wash my feet, but wash my hatred as well. Not only wash my feet, wash my evil. Not only wash my feet, wash my bitterness. Not only wash my feet, Lord, wash my injustice. Wash not only my feet, wash my resentment. Help me to heal. Help me to wash that away so I can be free and loving. Not only wash my feet, wash my lust and sinful passions. Not only my feet, Lord, wash away my addictions. Wash away my laziness. Wash away all of the things that somehow cling onto me and change who I am meant to be. Not only my feet, wash away my wickedness. Let the Lord wash away all of this in the land and in us, that there may be peace, that there may be love, there may be tranquility and hopefulness in his name. Our prayer today is a simple prayer. In your loving kindness, Lord, wash me. Amen.
Amen.
those parishioners who have been invited to participate in this part of the Mass, can you please come forward? Are the ushers helping us with cheers?
During the washing of the feet, we will be singing hymn number 98, found on page 140, "As I Have Done For You," hymn number 98.
Thank you.
Trusting in God, let us now turn our attention and asking for our needs and our concerns, both for ourselves and those who are here with us. May the good Lord hear us and bless us.
For the church, may Christ's true presence among us strengthen us in service to one another. We pray the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For elected leaders, may Christ's service to his church be a model for their service to their people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those suffering from doubt, may their faith be strengthened through the gift of the Eucharist. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those gathered here, may God grant us the wisdom to serve through faithful listening. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all who have gone, may they soon behold the true presence of the Lord in heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For our brothers and sisters in Eastern Europe, may there be a peaceful solution to their travails. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
In a moment of silence, we mention the individual personal intentions we bring to the celebration of the Eucharist. For these, and for all the intentions included in our books of remembrance, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Be present, O Lord, to your people and friends, so that what they do not have the confidence or presumption to ask, they may obtain by the merits of your Son's passion, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Okay. Please be seated.
The preparation and the hymn number 497. We remember hymn number 497.
In your glory, O Lord.
Pray, my dear friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands, for the praise of the Lord of his name, for our good and the laws of the Holy
Spirit. Amen. Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries. For whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord. Always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ and Lord. For he is a true and eternal priest, who instituted the pattern of an everlasting sacrifice, and was the first to offer himself as the saving patron. Coming to us to make his offering, as his memory of, as we eat his flesh and was sacrificed for us, we are made strong and we drink his blood that was poured. We are washed clean and sanctified. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we hear our praise. Together with your servant, Francis, our Pope, and Edward, our Bishop, and all those who hold him to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all those that are here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them, we offer you this sacrifice of praise, all they offer it for themselves, and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. Celebrating the most sacred day on which our Lord Jesus Christ was handed over for our sake, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious Ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, our spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Lyons, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Connecticut, Secret, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, Francis the Sales, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protection, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family we commit to you as we observe the day on which our Lord Jesus Christ handed on the mysteries of his body and blood for his disciples to celebrate. Order our days in your peace and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O Lord, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve these offerings in every respect, make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, for the salvation and the salvation of all, that is today, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you
celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord. We, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as ones who were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offerings of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through his participation at the altar received the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and blessing through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Remember, Lord, also your servants and those who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in the sleep of Christ. We remember our dear pastor, Father Bob Taminga. We remember Father Bob Kearney. For those in our lives who have died, who have served this parish, many in your own lives and families and friends. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and apostles, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Oh, given with thee, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Sign of peace. Thank you.
This is the body that will be given up for you. This is the chalice of the new covenant in my blood, says the Lord. Do this whenever you receive it in memory of me. Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that just as we are renewed by this supper of your Son in this present age, so we may enjoy his banquet for all eternity, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Thank you very, very much for being here tonight. Thank you for your patience. Thanks to all the many people who did so much behind the scenes to get us to this point. Let us take a moment to thank our all the servers today. There's a little kid up there who is thinking, I can do better than that. Please let us know. And we will definitely do better than that. So thank you. We need a lot more altar servers. Thank you very much. Thank you to the deacons. Thank you to the choir. Thank you very, very much. And the very main thing that the volunteers who have done so much here in the church in the last couple of days. They're still doing a lot of work ongoing, but I want to take this moment to thank you. We have got to the point now where we are going to transfer the Most Blessed Sacrament to the altar of repose. As you can see, the tabernacle is empty and it will remain open all week, we have a premium until Holy Saturday. The order of procession, the cross and the candles will go, the choir will follow, and then all of you will join. The Olivet room is not the biggest room, at least for tonight, it's not the biggest room. There are some chairs in there. If you don't think you want to cramp yourself in there, don't. But find some space around the altar of repose, see if you can fit. And then there's room, obviously, in the patio outside as well. So let's see what fits. So we will go over to the altar of repose. And for those who can stay, I know it is a little late, it's about 7:30. For some of you, it's probably past your bedtime already. But thank you for still sticking out with us. If you would like to stay for a couple of moments to pray with Christ Jesus and keep in adoration, you are most welcome to do so. We will have benediction at 11 p.m. and everyone can go home. If you want to go home and come back later on, that is perfect, fine, awesome. Thank you.
The hymn during the transfer of the Most Blessed Sacrament will be Panche Lingua Gloriosa. It's hymn number 268. Panche Lingua, hymn number 268.